Good afternoon, everyone. This is Kevin Gianni from the Renegade Health Show, and today we have part three of our series with Richard Moss. Today he's going to be talking about how type A type people, people who are real high energetic type people, Emery's pointing right at me, can forget about the future, forget about the past, and just kind of be. And really what that does is that drops stress levels significantly, and you know what that does for your health. It's a good thing. Check it out.
So let me ask you this. You know, I would say that myself and a lot of other people who are in the health kind of the healthy eating space and people who want to do the best for their body in terms of health, I mean, that requires a little bit of a type A type personality, I think, just in my experience. And so the type A person is someone who is generally planning, they're looking at the past, looking in the future. You know, I mean, how does someone not do that and still be able to succeed or do what they want to do?
Well, but yes, first we have to understand that there is only the now. We never live anyplace else.
Yeah.
Then you have a choice. There's five different kinds of nows. There's the present moment, right this moment, you and I are talking.
Yeah.
And if this moment is not conditioned by a thought, then it is the pure present moment, feeling, perceiving, sensing, awake. There's also four other nows. The now that's created by the stories you tell yourself about the past, which might create guilt or regret or positive nostalgia or, you know, negative nostalgia. Or there's the now that's created by the stories of the future, which create hope or fear, positive expectancy, negative expectancy. So it's always now. The question is your now being created by the stories you tell you about yourself that are making you depressed or making you superior? Or is this a now that's being created by your stories about your wife or your husband or about your job, which is causing you to be angry or envious or jealous or resentful or bitter? Okay, if we understand that it's always now, then the thing you want to do with the past, for example, is really plumb the past. Really look carefully. Here are my memories. What are the stories I tell myself about these memories? And what do these stories create in the present moment? Because if your father left the family when you were 11 years old, and now you're 50, and you're still telling the story, my father abandoned the family when I was 11 years old, you're going to still feel angry, or you're going to still feel like a victim. And 40 years have gone by. So in terms of the past, you want to really examine it and plumb it and see what you're telling yourself and realize these are just thoughts about my memories. These are not the actual truth of what was lived at that time. Same thing is true for the future. You're talking about how do we plan the future? Well, one of the most wonderful things in life is to try to anticipate the future and build a future. Me, personally, my whole life is about trying to create a future in which every human being wants to be part of the world that we collectively create. Now, that doesn't mean that I'm going to be attached to getting there. It means I'm going to have one foot, metaphorically speaking, firmly planted in the present moment while I go ahead and make plans for the future. Those plans are in service to the dedication of my life. And the dedication of my life is to help diminish conflict and suffering in the world. So I plan that. How do I plan that? I plan that by planning my programs. I plan that by thinking about what I want to share in those programs. I plan that by thinking who I want to invite to work with me or contribute to it, and on and on. It's a joy to plan the future. I'm just not attached to getting there.
You mentioned the ego before. Is it possible to entirely clear the ego?
Well, you know, that's a pretty good, arguable question. I would say yes, that at the level of personal consciousness, the level of personal ego, you can, by waking up when you're in the middle of a me story and stopping it, and understanding where it would take you, that let's say it takes you to grandiosity or aloofness or superiority. Waking up in the middle of a past story and recognizing that if you stay with that past story, it's going to take you to regret. Or waking up in the middle of a you story and realize that that story is going to take you into anger or resentment. And if you work carefully with your own stories, you will clear your personal consciousness. That's doable. But we don't just have a personal consciousness. We swim in an ocean of vast consciousness. Carl Jung talked about the collective unconscious. And there are forces bigger than our personal consciousness. And I don't believe that any of us can clear those, but I do know that whoever clears their ego fairly well then begins to work in service to the healing of the collective consciousness. So you become an instrument for uplifting your brothers and sisters everywhere in the world through the field of consciousness you've created by no longer living in your stories about yourself, by no longer living in stories that make you superior or inferior, stories that make you angry or resentful and so forth. And, big, big and, you won't clear your ego and your personal consciousness until you've been able to hold the feelings that you've been afraid to feel or running away from in your life. Feelings like abandonment, feelings like emptiness, feelings like a profound almost disorientation as if you don't know that you, almost like a feeling of non-existence. These are some of the deeply, deeply frightening feelings that all human beings experience at times. And those of us that experience them and then run away from them into stories that create, for example, anger or depressiveness, we're the victim of those feelings. But as I explain very carefully in the book and outline step by step, there are ways, and of course it does take practice, that we can learn to hold these feelings in a very healthy way. And you don't learn it all at once. You learn it gradually over and over again. In the same way as that you don't become a good batter in baseball until, you know, tens of thousands of pitches have been thrown at you, towards you, and you've swung and missed and swung and missed and begun gradually. Because, you know, when we watch baseball, we're looking at people who have, you know, spent thousands and thousands of hours watching a baseball come at them and swing a bat, and you know that a high batting average is around 300, which means that 3 times out of 10 you actually get a base hit, and that's not an easy thing to do. It takes enormous amount of practice, and it similarly takes practice for a person to realize, you know, there is a way that I've been chased in my life from feelings. Just the other day, someone was saying she was in 2 marriages, divorced 2 times, stayed at least 10 years too long in both those marriages, and she said, because I was afraid of being alone. Huh. Just like that. Now, she was super honest, an interesting woman, probably in her early 70s, saying, I was afraid to be alone, so I stayed in these relationships. I was in Denmark at the time, as a Danish woman. Because I was afraid to be alone. Okay, so aloneness can keep us in marriages that are destructive. Aloneness can keep us not living our lives fully because we're afraid of that feeling. And we have to learn, if you're afraid of aloneness, you'll stay with somebody, but there'll never be any love in that relationship. But if you're not afraid of aloneness, then when you stay with someone for a completely different reason, and there's a real possibility of deep love forming between the two of you. But aloneness has chased many, many people away from their true self, away from speaking the truth, away from asking for what they want in a relationship, away from taking the risk that they might be rejected, and as a result, living very repressed lives in relationships that don't fulfill them, all because they're afraid of aloneness. So my prescription as a former doctor for the deep illness of the world, we're not talking here about the illnesses caused by bad diet, which you and I could have a wonderful conversation about, but I know you do that all the time. So we're not talking about heart disease and cancer and diabetes and things like that. We're talking about war and conflict and emotional conflict and bitter divorces and families turning against each other and nations turning against each other. And the reason for that is that we still identify with our thinking. We believe our own thoughts and we don't question and challenge them. And we are afraid of our feelings, and the way we adapt ourselves to protect ourselves from feelings instead of learning to consciously be present with these feelings has caused us to do very destructive things.
Your question of the day, type A, yes or no? Go ahead and post it down below. This is Kevin Gianni from the Renegade Health Show, together we change the health of the world, one show at a time.